Today on Studio One, older theaters have a certain lasting charm. We'll take a close look at a restoration project that benefits its community. Also, the weather is an important part of our lives that often dictates what we wear and if we can travel or not. We'll put you in the shoes of someone who helps make our decisions easier. And we'll preview the movie, The Object of My Affection.
Now, from the University of North Dakota, this is Studio One.
Hi, everyone, and welcome to Studio One.
Thanks for joining us.
Well, it's that time of year again. I wonder how many people were up until midnight doing their taxes.
Tax season is a little stressful.
Yes,
the for accountants, too.
That's right. I know someone who's an accountant, and they were pulling, I think, 18-hour days just to get, you know, this whole month of April getting their things done.
Mm-hmm.
But we are, as a matter of fact, we are getting more taxed now than we had been in the 50s. In the 50s, 28% of our income on average was taxed, and now it's 10% higher.
Hmm.
But that could be a good
thing. Yeah, some people do think that is a good thing.
More social programs and things like that.
Right. So.
Well, coming up on the show, most kids get excited about going to the circus. We'll talk to someone who took this excitement one step further.
Also, we'll meet a man who is considered by many as a champion of American agriculture.
But first, today's news with Derek Walters.
Thank you very much, Michelle and Monty. Hello there. Pol Pot, ousted leader of the Khmer Rouge regime, has died. The former Cambodian leader is responsible for the deaths of up to 2 million Cambodians through mass execution, disease, and starvation in the mid-1970s. The body of the hardline communist leader was put on display, allowing people to confirm reports of his death. The government has asked that the body be turned over to them for additional confirmation. Pol Pot has not been seen outside his Khmer Rouge inner circle for two decades until recently. The Vietnamese invasion in 1979 forced the Khmer Rouge to retreat back into the jungle, and Pol Pot spent the following years on the run. The cause of his death has not been confirmed. Some reports claim it was a heart attack. In other news, hotter, fresher, and faster. That's the attitude McDonald's is taking thanks to the new state-of-the-art kitchen. The McDonald's Corporation has announced plans to install new computerized kitchens in its franchises across the U.S. According to a McDonald's spokeswoman, the new food prep system will be more consistent and speedier than the existing setup. Each order will be made fresh to better satisfy the customer. The kitchens cost around $25,000 and are expected to hit franchises by the end of next year. Whether the computers will replace human labor has not yet been determined. Your initials may help determine how long you live. Believe it or not, a study of nearly 3,500 death certificates in California shows that males whose initials spell positive words such as VIP or WIN live about 4.5 years longer than men with initials that spell a neutral word or no word at all. One psychologist involved in the study says negative initials such as rat or bug were associated with higher rates of suicide and accidents, causes of death that have clear psychological components. For women, those positive initials lived more than 3 years longer, but there were no years lost among women with negative initials. April has been proclaimed both Child Abuse Prevention Month and the Month of the Young Child. In observation, parents and kids recently participated in the hands-on learning fair to prove that when you're learning, the fun has just begun.
Hands-on learning in early childhood provides the foundation children need for later classroom learning. Through play activities, children develop numerous skills like problem solving and increased motor capabilities. Organizers of the Hands-On Learning Fair in Grand Forks, North Dakota, had several goals in mind when planning the event.
We want people to know the nature of learning during the early years. It's not memorizing ABCs or numbers. It's not, you know, reading flashcards, doing worksheets, anything like that. It's very hands-on, interactive, fueled by children's own motivation, which is their extreme curiosity.
When children are in the early childhood years, they experience the most rapid brain development of their life. Everything from emotional development to social skills building takes place, and the appropriate education can stir early interests that have many long-term benefits. Volunteers from around the community showed their dedication to children by giving their time and resources to the event.
We're trying to just encourage kids to like books and come and visit us at the library.
A popular display was oobleck, a mixture of cornstarch and water. Kids like to get their hands in the gooey stuff while learning about the physical properties of solids and liquids. Many kids had important goals to accomplish during the day.
I want to have my face painted.
Organizers and volunteers are already looking forward to next year's hands-on learning fair. Most of the same activities will be back to challenge kids as their size and abilities change. I'm Joanna Yamlin reporting for Studio One.
Grand Forks area residents are being encouraged to tie purple ribbons to trees, their lapels, and their cars to show their support of children in the community and the state of North Dakota. That's the news for this half, and now here's Michelle and Monty.
Thanks, Derek. I thought I saw the Cat in the Hat from Dr. Seuss in there.
I think I saw that too. That's a cute costume.
Reading is an important part of the education for
kids. It really is. And many cities around the nation do have summer reading programs so that kids don't lose that ability during the summer. And that's really important for them too.
And I think actually in Grand Forks, North Dakota, they have one of those programs set up exactly for that.
They
right?
do, they do. And it's a wonderful program. It's very popular. And a lot of kids really have fun with it too. So
good.
That's great. And I know they're looking forward to summer too because it is nice weather. Let's go now to Brian Schrader at the Regional Weather Information Center for our forecast. Brian, what kind of weather can we expect?
Well, I'm looking forward to summer too, but it's just not here yet. It's kind of a chilly day across the Grand Forks area, and for right now, it's looking like a few of these days will be in store for us. Right now, we have a temperature of 49 degrees, so it has dropped off a degree in the past hour. Our dew point is at 24, so it is on the dry side. Our wind is out of the north at 16 miles per hour, gusting up to 24. Our atmospheric pressure is at 30 inches of mercury, and we do have a relative humidity of 37%. Looking at the regional conditions across the tri-state area, a little cool out there, a lot of 40s and 50s showing up, but we also have a lot of sunshine out there. 44 up in International Falls, 51 down in Sioux Falls, and we see a lot of the same as we move out to the west, a lot of 40s and 50s. Looking at our current jet stream, we do have a big trough built in through the central portions of the U.S., and as we know by now, that's going to allow that cool air to drop in. But if we take a look at the beginning portions of next week, we're going to have a large ridge building into the west, and that means a return of warm air for much of the northern Great Plains. Looking at our current surface chart, we do have a low over to our east, and that's combining with the high sitting over us to give us that clockwise flow around the high and the counterclockwise flow around the low, bringing in some northerly winds, and that's going to cool us down just a little bit. But for right now, we're looking at mostly sunny conditions across much of the area. Going into tomorrow, that low is going to shift a little farther to the south. We do have a low moving in from the west, and this is going to be affecting our weather by bringing in some clouds. But you can see how slow this thing moves through. We're not expecting too much out of it because it is moving so slow, but we do have the chance for some cool weather, possibly some rain showers on Sunday, so don't expect a big change in our weather over the next few days.
Okay, thank you, Brian.
Well, it's an exciting time of the year with weather. Mm-hmm. It's changing into spring. We're getting mm-hmm. closer to summer. And also in the sports world, we've got hockey playoffs going on.
Right.
Baseball starting up. Real exciting stuff.
It is a dynamic time of the year.
It is. And Tony Stein is here to tell us more about sports.
Thank you, Monty and Michelle. The only thing more exciting than Jamestown native Darren Erstad batting .421 with four homers and a 12-game hitting streak was the Wednesday episode of Jerry Springer Baseball held at Jacobs Field in Cleveland. The Indians were hosting the Mariners Wednesday night, third period. Just a bit inside to Kenny Lofton, the big unit, Randy Johnson. He didn't like that one. Lofton didn't like that one. And Mariners manager Lou Piniella had to be held back. I don't know what he's throwing there. Probably a tantrum. Then the next pitch, just a bit inside to Kenny Lofton again. This time the bench is clear. Johnson's holding his ground. And when you're 6'11", you can hold your ground, I guess. Then Sandy Alomar Jr. got ejected, Kenny Lofton was ejected, and Randy Johnson was ejected. Top of the eighth, David Segee with the double down the left field line and an RBI. Ken Griffey Jr. scores. Mariners come from behind to win this one 5-3. Pistons and the Bulls playing in Detroit. Bulls on a one-game losing streak. Jordan with the reverse layup. He had 19 points on the night, but the Pistons answer back, and it was all Pistons from there. Jerry Stackhouse with 20 points. But the big man was Brian Williams for the Pistons. Here with the athletic left-hand layup, Williams had 25 points and 17 rebounds. Pistons only their second win in 10 games. The Bulls fall one half game behind the Jazz for the home court advantage in the playoffs. The University of North Dakota track team has moved outdoors with the coming of spring. One athlete on the team has been jumping at the chance to get outside since the end of the indoor season. Mark Sondrell, a fourth-year student at UND, has been in track since high school. He is a two-time North Central Conference high jump champion and has placed twice in the Nationals, a third place in 97, and a second place this year with a personal best of 7 feet and 1/4 inches. Sondrell has many goals in life, but one comes far before any of the others.
That's my ultimate goal, is just to please God probably most. And then from there, I think if I do that first, I think high jump and everything else would just come nice.
While Sondrell is working to achieve this goal, he has achieved many others within the sport and within the school. This would be Sondrell's last year of eligibility, but due to the flood, he can participate in the outdoor season next year. And now it's time for the Studio One Center Stumper Sports Trivia Question of the Week. This week's question is, which football player has one Super Bowl ring and was the 1982 Heisman Trophy winner? The only clue I have for you is that he just recently retired from the NFL. I'll have the answer in the next half of sports, Monty and Michelle.
Thanks, Tony. Still ahead on Studio One, we'll learn about the science behind predicting the future.
And we'll learn about the twists and turns of an acrobat's career.
Voller Insurance, 50 years of providing our customers with competitive premiums, broader coverage, and VIP service in Grand Forks, Fargo, Bismarck, and Devil's Lake.
Consider extending your learning into the summer months at the University of North Dakota. UND Summer Session is a great opportunity for all students. Summer classes can help you graduate early or on time. Raise your GPA while taking shorter courses with fewer classmates. Summer Session allows you to work and still take classes. Financial aid is available for those who qualify. Classes start in May and June. Registration begins April 6th. Call 1-800-CALL-UND for details.
UND's Division of Continuing Education can help you learn throughout your lifetime. Begin or continue your education through correspondence study and learning after hours with classes on weekends and evenings. Or enhance your personal and professional development through conferences, management seminars, and specialized programs.
Our goal is to provide quality programs and extend UND resources to you.
For more information, call 777-4266 or 1-800-342-8230.
The 1998 Chevrolet CK pickup offers impressive room, comfort, and style. Rydell's in Grand Forks invites you to experience a truck you can depend on over the miles and through the years. Features like push-button four-wheel drive, airbags, anti-lock brakes, optional third door, and more make each day easier and each drive more enjoyable. See the full line of Chevrolet's full-size CK pickups at Rydell's Chevrolet Oldsmobile Cadillac, 2700 South Washington, Grand Forks.
Voller Insurance, 50 years of providing our customers with competitive premiums, broader coverage, and VIP service in Grand Forks, Fargo, Bismarck, and Devil's Lake.
Life under the big top was a barrel of monkeys for Bobby Avramski. He joined the Bulgarian State Circus at age 12, traveling across Europe, Finland, Russia, Bulgaria, and Czechoslovakia. At age 16, he made his way to Las Vegas, where he performed with Circus Circus and Circus Vargas. Joining us today is Bobby Avramski.
Hello, Monty.
Thank you very much for coming on the show. We saw you tumbling in the air, flying through the air, doing your tricks for the circus. How did you ever get involved with something so exciting?
Okay, the story starts when I was 6. That's when I joined gymnastics. And about 4 years later, I really fell in love in the circus because my father was taking me to the circus. And I had several other friends from the gymnastics gym that I was training in. They joined the circus before me.
So you were following your friends in a little bit of a way.
Yes, but I was 10 at the time, so I wanted to go to the circus, and my parents said no.
So how did you get there then, if they said no?
2 years of very persistent.
Begging your parents,
yes.
In other words, right? Well, how did that affect your childhood, growing up with the circus?
It made me grow up really fast. I had to grow up in a snap.
Okay.
Because I didn't have my parents to be taking care of me. I had to learn to wash my clothes, cook my dinner, and do all that fun stuff.
When you were 12 years old, mm-hmm. you were learning how to do this.
Yes.
And you also came to the United States away from your home country at a very early age, too.
I was 16.
16 when you came over. How did you come to Las Vegas?
After my first encounter with the circus when I was 12, I was with the circus for about 2 years, and then I got dropped from the circus. And because the boss's son turned the legal age to perform in the circus. Mm-hmm. And they dropped me off because of that. And I met a person in the gym that I used to train in, who was in the circus at the time, and he was helping with the coaching in the gym during the winter when all circuses are traveling. And he told me, okay, you're dropped from the circus, don't worry, no big deal, I will look out for you to see if I can find you a job. And I was 14 at the time, and 2 years later, on April 2nd in the morning, that's right after April Fool's Day, I was on crutches at the time. I had operation done on my foot because I did a somersault backflip on in a nightclub, and I broke my foot, so I had to have operation done on it. And the telephone rang in the morning, woke me up, and I answered, and the person on the other side said, "May I speak with Boris Avramski?" And I said, "Yes, that's me." And he said, "Well, do you still want to join the circus?" And I said, "Yes." And he said, "Well, how about coming to America?"
So then you came to Las Vegas then?
Well, what I told the person right at that moment, I said, "Okay, now you can give the telephone to Gonzo," and which is a friend of mine. I thought that he was making a joke still on April Fool's Day.
So what is something that we don't see that happens on in the circus? Like, what are the conditions like living in a circus?
Okay, I guess a lot of people will say that's crazy, but we live in trailers. We travel. I lived in the back of a truck for 5 years in a room that's 5x7. And during the in Circus Vargas, where we initially performed in the States, we did 4 seasons with Circus Vargas. They will shut off the electric power at 12 o'clock at night to save fuel for from the generators. But they will leave the power on only when it's very cold at night, and not because of us, the performers, it's because of the elephants.
They want to keep the elephants nice and comfortable.
Yes.
Okay. Well, one last question. Behind the scenes, is there anything that you think that people would be amazed at seeing in the circus?
Behind the scenes? No.
Probably.
Just the traveling. You get a chance to travel and to see a lot of things. That's the most amazing thing for me.
Well, obviously you've traveled quite a bit coming all the way from overseas. So
yeah.
Thank you very much for coming on the show today, Bobby, and sharing your experience with us.
You're welcome, Andy.
Coming up on the show, one of the TV's hottest stars is shining again on the big screen. But first, we'll meet a man whose job is constantly changing.
It's lunchtime, and what are we having with our burger today? Wow, you get a big 28 grams of fat with this one. And this one serves up an amazing 39 grams. A great sandwich doesn't have to have all that fat. At Subway, 7 of our 6-inch subs have 6 grams of fat or less and taste fresh and delicious. Take the Subway challenge and take one bite. If you don't think our subs are great, you get your money back at a Subway near you.
Put together quality faculty with quality programs, with superb students and all kinds of neat opportunities, you're going to get literally a world-class education. And that's what we can provide at the University of North Dakota.
coming here, you do meet a lot of people from different cultures, and it's really broadened my horizons a lot, kept me more open-minded.
I really like the professors here. They're always available. You can go in and talk to them whenever you need them.
It really has everything to offer. You don't need to go far away to get a really good education anymore.
The School of Law at the University of North Dakota is steeped in tradition. From the first graduating class, students today learn from the Modern Law Library and computer labs. Students write for the North Dakota Law Review, take part in moot court, and review court proceedings with video technology. Law and medical students compete in the annual Malpractice Bowl.
The size of our student body gives great access to their teachers, and our computer network allows us to access worldwide legal resources.
Look up the UND School of Law for more opportunities.
A question most people ask is, how's the weather? Today we stop by the place where people not only know what's happening on the ground, but also what's going on in the sky.
Meteorologists of the National Weather Service can look forward to a different day at the office every day of the week. Meteorologist David Soroka says that can be expected, as weather is three-dimensional activity that changes every minute. David's responsibilities include examining clouds conditions, which indicate wind speed and direction, and observing rain and snow levels.
The rain or snow falls into the cone here. If it's snow, it'll melt and then drop in there. In rain, liquid will fall in through the hole here and then come into a cylinder.
There is a special nationwide program that's broadcast around the clock to keep people informed about severe weather conditions. This is a flood phone where meteorologists code the latest flood statements, such as river levels and dates of possible crests.
The most interesting aspect of forecasting is just that you're trying to predict the future from computer models and determining what's going to happen from very little information at times.
David says he likes keeping people updated.
Running part of the job, I believe, is coming in and figuring out the science to the best of my ability and able to put out a forecast on my own that proves to be accurate. And
besides, it's never the same. I am Ekaterina Glot for Studio One.
David says he should always be prepared with a forecast. His friends and family always ask him what to expect. The Object of My Affection is a contemporary romantic comedy that pushes the lines between love, sex, and friendship. Paul Rudd plays a gay man about to be dumped at a dinner party. The stranger that tells him the bad news is played by Jennifer Aniston. He accepts her invitation to live in her apartment, and one of the most important relationships of their lives begins. In the months that follow, they become the best of friends, a fact which is unsettling to her boyfriend.
But you're not a threat to her, huh? Is that the attraction?
I'm not sure. I don't know.
You know what I mean, George. You're not offering her anything more than friendship.
Of course I'm not offering her anything more than friendship.
Aniston's character announces that she is pregnant and that she wants to raise the baby with her gay roommate instead of her boyfriend. A decision he is not happy with. The Object of My Affection opens in theaters on April 17th. Now time to look at the events happening in your area.
With the right methods, the mix of violence and children can be prevented. The question of exactly how has been raised in light of the recent shooting and deaths of five people in Jonesboro, Arkansas, by two young boys. This was the fourth U.S. child-related shooting incident in 5 months. Suggested solutions include restricting firearms and educating our children. Here are your thoughts on how we can prevent children from committing violence.
What their kids are doing, they shouldn't even be able to have access to guns at that age. If they do, their parents should know about it.
Kids need a good home life. They need good
discipline in family life. They need parents around to know that there's always that love and support there, and there's somebody they can talk to.
Music that has like bad lyrics and lyrics that suggest killing and rape and everything has a big part to do with kids that are violent and that act up.
Kids are out running around and terrorizing neighborhoods and shooting up people and getting a hold of guns when things are. You know, then the parents should have been there, you know. So if you punish the parents, then maybe they'll pay more attention.
Once night falls, a police officer's job becomes a little more complicated. Fortunately, one highway patrol officer has an advantage. He can see in the dark.
Officer Frank LaRocque has been with the highway patrol for several years. In that time, he has seen advances in police technology. One such advantage is in his own assigned patrol car. The device is called Night Sight and uses infrared light to allow him to see objects at night.
It's a forward-looking infrared unit. It takes heat from the objects outside and forms a photographic image of it.
On the monitor in his car, objects appear just as clear as they would during the day. The Night Sight camera is mounted to the top of the patrol car and can move 360 degrees as well as up and down. Frank says it was easy to learn how to operate Night Sight. He says the Night Sight device is one of the few in the state of North Dakota and is a valuable tool. While it has its drawbacks, like the images being distorted during rain or snow, Night Sight does serve its purpose.
You can imagine the scenarios it can be used on escaped prisoners, hostage situations, stolen vehicles, missing persons, like people hiding out in tall grass. Yeah, it'll see them.
So the next time you see some strange-looking object on the top of a patrol car, just smile and wave, because they can see you, whether it's day or night. This is Shelley Eisensee, reporting for Studio One.
Officer LaRocque says he is used to having night sight in his car, and being without it would be like going back to the dark ages. Ahead on the show, we'll talk to a man who has been a key player in balancing the federal budget, plus a look at a historical landmark and the change it has gone through. That story plus news, sports, and the weather in the next half hour on Studio One.
Consider extending your learning into the summer months at the University of North Dakota. UND Summer Session is a great opportunity for all students. Summer classes can help you graduate early or on time. Raise your GPA while taking shorter courses with fewer classmates. Summer Session allows you to work and still take classes. Financial aid is available for those who qualify. Classes start in May and June. Registration begins April 6th. Call 1-800-CALL-UND for details.
You've been waiting for a sedan that's both practical and fun to drive. Oldsmobile thinks you've waited long enough. Rydell's in Grand Forks invites you to experience Intrigue by Oldsmobile, the perfect combination of sport and luxury. Once you've discovered the smooth, quiet ride and unmatched safety features of Intrigue, you won't settle for anything less. The all-new Intrigue. Best priced at Rydell Chevrolet Oldsmobile Cadillac, 2700 South Washington, Grand Forks.
What do all these company symbols have in common? This symbol. For more than 20 years, Century Creations Printing has provided creative printing solutions to these companies and many more. Customers know they can trust Century Creations to produce high-quality printing. They also know they can work directly with Century's award-winning graphic arts department to design a print piece that will help them achieve their goals. Creative printing solutions from Century Creations Printing. Now in their new expanded location at 5203 Gateway Drive in Grand Forks.
Loan rejected.
Some computer in another city rejects me. Solid credit. I've had the same job for years.
Rejected.
Now let's look at Community.
Thank goodness Community treats you differently. Here you're a person, not just a number. And when you apply for a loan, Community will talk with you, they'll work with you, and they'll do it fast. Like Jerry Lee with my home equity loan.
You're approved.
Wow, that was fast. And personal, too.
They really do care about you.
Now, from the University of North Dakota, with Monica Schell and Michelle Midstock, this is Studio One.
Welcome back to Studio One.
Thanks for joining us.
You know, last year at this time, we were all heading into the worst flood we've seen this century.
That's right, and even longer, I think. It was a terrible time with a lot mm-hmm. of great moments that came out of that as well. A lot of heroes came through. Recently,
that's true.
The Grand Forks Herald, the newspaper in the city, won a Pulitzer Prize mm-hmm. for their coverage of the flood during when their building got flooded, then it got burned down to the ground.
Right.
So
a lot of challenges, and we're going to be talking today with a United States Senator who has experienced many challenges in getting money into North Dakota for the flood and recovery. So we're looking forward to talking to him.
Yep, and the recovery is going good. Coming up also in the next 30 minutes on Studio One, we'll learn about a trade-off that involves Coke on ice.
And we'll take you on a tour through an art center that is bringing business back to downtown Grand Forks.
We'll also find out what our leaders in Washington, D.C. have in store for us. But first, national and regional news with Derek Walters.
All right, thanks very much. Hello again. A tornado hidden in darkness blew through northeastern Arkansas and western Tennessee early Thursday morning, killing 4 people. At least one other tornado was sighted later in the day, but sirens designed to warn residents were inoperable because power lines were downed by earlier storms. Many buildings, mobile homes, and estimated 200 other structures were damaged in the storm.
My whole house was shaking, and then I woke up, and then my window busted out, and then me and Justin got in the closet and hid, and we came out, and it was like this.
At least 22 people were injured in the storm. One fire official says that 2 of the 4 people who died were children around the ages of 3 and 8. All of the deaths were related to mobile home accidents. Parents sending a teen to college should know that checking up on health insurance coverage could be good first aid for their bank accounts. 1/3 of U.S. college students have no health insurance. Those who do usually have too little coverage or don't know how to access care providers. Students covered on their parents' policy should be aware that they may become too old for their parents' health plan.
I would encourage students when they come, first of all, to ask their parents, am I covered on our policy and how long? And should I get health insurance? So that thing, at least check into it and see what's available.
Students not covered by their parents' plan may have the option of getting a private plan or accessing insurance available through their school. The U.S. government is proposing new rules intended to provide organs to those who need them the most. The current system allocates organs locally first. Technology now allows surgeons to preserve organs for hours, allowing them to be shipped long distances. The United Network of Organ Sharing opposes the plan. They say the new proposal puts decision-making in the hands of the government rather than keeping it in the hands of doctors and patients. However, with this new system, location won't affect whether or not patients are able to receive the organs they need. The choice between Coke and Pepsi has always been a free decision for most people, but some high schools and colleges across the country are now earning millions of dollars by making that decision for their students.
Soft drink companies are offering high schools and universities big bucks for exclusive rights to advertise and sell their products at schools. One school district in Texas is receiving $4.2 million over 15 years from Coca-Cola to advertise their products. 2 years ago, a selection committee at the University of North Dakota chose Coca-Cola to fill its vending machines.
The advantage of having a corporate entity on our campus serves a need for our current students several years past now, but the branded concept is what we call it. Students and staff alike identify with a brand.
With Coke, UND is able to earn 40% commission on its vending sales. When the Grand Forks School District sought out a vendor to bid on its schools, they chose a shared contract with Coke and Pepsi. Craig Perry, the athletic director for the Grand Forks School District, says the soft drink companies have cornered their market.
If you're able to capture the school district, the park district, and the university, you pretty much have captured the entire community. And so it's for them, it's guaranteeing your sales.
However, Perry says without the support of large companies, high school and college athletics would suffer. Corporate sponsors allow athletic departments to build new facilities, give scholarships, and buy new equipment.
For example, at Cushman Field, we had a scoreboard go down 2 years ago, and Coca-Cola came to me and said, we'll be willing to purchase a new scoreboard for you. So I could look for some way to get some sponsorship for that.
At UND, the new $50,000 Zamboni is being paid for by Coca-Cola over 10 years. In exchange, the Zamboni is painted in Coke's bright red logo. One spokesperson for UND Athletics says they appreciate Koch's involvement.
It's a challenge, and that's where having good sponsors like Koch and Rydell Chevrolet and some of Subway and some of our other larger sponsors have really helped us maintain the success level we've got.
But some controversy has risen as to the real reason companies have their products in schools. Some school district officials say that exclusive corporate contracts interfere with their educational mission and limit student choice. But with so much money to be gained, those are sacrifices many schools are willing to make.
The Koch contract at UND will be up in the year 2000. At that time, the university will either switch to the Pepsi generation or stick with ice-cold Coca-Cola. There is new information parents must remember to ensure their child's car seat works effectively. In the past, parents were told to wait until the baby weighed 20 pounds before switching them from a rear-facing seat to one that faces towards the front of the car. Car seat guidelines now recommend that parents must wait until the child is at least 20 pounds and a year old before making the switch, as well as the direction of the baby faces, the position in which the restraint system is placed in the vehicle can affect the safety of the infant in a collision.
What we recommend for infants 20 pounds and under is that they be in a reclining cradle position instead of the upright to support their head and rear facing in the seat.
When the infant is in the cradled rear facing seat, the neck and spine are supported better in a crash, which reduces the risk of spine and nerve damage. That's the news for today. And now once more, here's Monty and Michelle.
Thanks, Derek. You know, when you think about it, it's only been the past few years that these car seats have come about.
Right.
And it's great that that's happening, but I remember when even I was a kid, mm-hmm. we were crawling all over the back of the station wagon during
right.
vacations and things.
Safety standards have really come a long way in all areas, and I'm happy to see that, especially with families traveling a lot this summer with nice weather, hopefully, and they can take care of their kids and be safe.
Yep.
We hope they can do that. Anyways, let's go now to Brian Schrader at the Regional Weather Information Center for our forecast. Brian, what's happening with the weather?
Well, as we saw earlier, we are sitting underneath a body of high pressure. We do have north winds across the Grand Forks area, bringing in some cooler weather, but we also have a trough out to our west. What's this going to give us for our forecast? Well, it's going to be another cool one across the Grand Forks area, a little bit warmer down to our south where they are expecting 30s, but as we can see, 20s over much of the area. For tomorrow, another warm day, we're looking at 50s, a little bit cooler up to the northeast with temperatures dropping down into the 40s. Our forecast for tonight, we're expecting partly cloudy skies, light winds out of the north with a low of 28 degrees. And for tomorrow, it's going to be partly cloudy, but it will be becoming mostly cloudy. Winds will be coming out of the west-southwest at 5 to 15 miles per hour with a high of 51 degrees. And in our 3 to 5 day forecast, it's looking almost the same on all 3 days. Temperatures in the low 50s to upper 40s, a slight chance of rain on Sunday, and overnight lows will be dropping down into the 30s. So overall, it looks like more of the same. A few clouds, maybe a chance of rain on Sunday, but some cooler temperatures.
Great. Thank you, Brian.
Well, have you grilled yet?
No, I haven't. I'm just glad that there isn't snow on the ground.
That's a good thing. I think it's time now we can break out the grills and start doing that.
I think we should.
Let's turn now first to Tony Stein with sports.
Thanks, Monty and Michelle. The University of North Dakota baseball team did not lose one home game last season. However, they did not win one either. Floodwaters struck out any hope for the postseason in 1997, and with this season in full stride, the Sioux hope to slide into the NCC tournament. The Fighting Sioux baseball team has not seen the postseason since 1995. This year, with a strong pitching rotation and a powerful batting lineup, Sioux head coach Kelvin Ziegler says the team simply needs to mold those two together for a productive season.
Again, the big thing right now is consistency. We just haven't had real good consistency as far as the offense and defense is concerned. But we feel as the season goes on and some of these kids get some experience and gain some confidence that we're going to be in a good situation again to make a run at everything.
Ziegler says North Central Conference games are won in the sixth and seventh innings when the good teams prevail. Two of those teams the Sioux are shooting for are Northern Colorado and Mankato State. This year, the pitching staff is led by left-hander and future Grand Forks Channel Cat Mike Rarick. Alongside him is senior right-hander Ryan Craig, who says the team needs to be fundamentally sound every day.
Right now, we're just not playing on a consistent level. You know, I mean, our pitching has been there in spots, and then sometimes our hitting's there in spots, so I think we just need to bring it all together, and I think we have a good shot at the playoffs.
The last time the Fighting Sioux appeared in the NCAA Division II College World Series was 1993. Although Craig says he would love to play for the Division II title, the Sioux need to focus on the postseason.
It's just going to be a fight just to get back into the playoff hunt, and hopefully we can accomplish that.
The North Central Conference postseason tournament will be held at Mankato State May 7th through the 10th. And as promised, the answer to the Studio One Steiner Stumper Sports Trivia Question of the Week. This week's question was, which football player has won Super Bowl ring and was the 1982 Heisman Trophy winner? Well, he was Marcus Allen. He had a fabulous 16-year career for that young man. That's it for sports today, Monty and Michelle.
Issues like disaster relief, agriculture, and the federal budget have kept politicians busy. Our next guest is no exception.
And an old building with a new look brings back memories and is sure to create many more. That story is next on Studio One.
Voller Insurance, 50 years of providing our customers with competitive premiums, broader coverage, and VIP service in Grand Forks, Fargo, Bismarck, and Devil's Lake.
Sioux pride. The championship tradition is strong at the UND Bookstore. Before the game, shop the UND Bookstore for the largest selection of officially licensed Sioux products. No matter what your sport, the UND Bookstore can help you show your Sioux colors. The UND Bookstore welcomes all alumni, friends, and Sioux fans. Shop for quality name brand clothing, Sioux collectibles, books, and supplies. Come to the UND Bookstore, located in the Student Union.
Basketball, football, volleyball. From youth through adult sizes, we've got them all. At Home of Economy, Highway 81 North, Grand Forks.
Let the University of North Dakota become your strategic partner by providing your business, industry, or organization with our workforce development services. Our experts work closely with you to enhance your workforce productivity. Together, we'll help you develop innovative and practical solutions. The Office of Workforce Development has extensive experience in customizing educational programs and services. Call us for further information. Workforce Development, a service of the University of North Dakota.
Voller Insurance, 50 years of providing our customers with competitive premiums, broader coverage, and VIP service in Grand Forks, Fargo, Bismarck, and Devil's Lake.
From the University of North Dakota, you're watching Studio One.
Many historical landmarks have went head-to-head with commercial developers and have lost. Recently, one special landmark in Grand Forks, North Dakota, that faced many challenges, reopened its doors.
The Empire Theater in Grand Forks, North Dakota, has had many names since it was first built in 1919. It was known as the Grand until films with sound were introduced and the name changed to the Paramount. In 1955, when it converted to CinemaScope, the name changed to the Empire, which it is called today. Before television made its debut, the theater was one of the more popular forms of entertainment.
Before that, was not unusual that we would completely sell out the theater at a 2 o'clock show, a 7 o'clock show on Sunday night, and a 9 o'clock show. Just about the people would stand outside in a line that might stretch for a block and a half waiting to get in. We were extremely busy. We seldom had, you know, the movie theaters were continually full at that time. I mean, weekends, Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday were poor nights for the movie, but the rest of the time, you know, and on Sunday, it was just a madhouse.
More than the name has changed over the years, both the inside and the outside were showing signs of deterioration. The latest major change took place in the early 1990s.
We started planning in 1993, fundraised in 1996, started construction January of 97, and we're looking towards a September date in 1997 for an opening. Then the flood hit, and it not only affected just the opening date by setting it back, but that in May we were going into a public campaign.
Many parts of the theater were already under construction when the devastating flood of 1997 hit. Many items had to be replaced, including the movie screen, glass chandeliers, and an electrical panel that had only been in place for 2 weeks.
So it was kind of disheartening, and to come in and see it all gone. But on the bright side, the seats were in Wisconsin being refurbished, and the stage flooring hadn't been put in yet. So there was, you know, some good things about it. We got lucky.
In 1992, a community cultural assessment was done by the North Valley Arts Council. It was determined that space was needed for local performing and visual artists. This was one reason for the renovation of the theater, but there were more reasons.
The project itself was considered important to the rebuilding of our downtown and prior to the flood, but since the flood, it's really taken on a much larger significance. It's really a rallying point and a focal point for all of us in the community.
This is an important theater for a lot of people. We'll have people walk through and talk about their first date here or remembering coming here and seeing Snow White as a kid. And it's something from the past, and historically it's important to have a link with the past, to remember what it was like. This is a chance to bring art back to the area, and also from a purely economic standpoint, this is something that's going to bring some money and some foot traffic downtown, and so on both fronts we're really proud.
Downtown businesses like Bonzer's, a sandwich shop and pub, have an interest in the theater and hope to benefit from the opening of the Empire.
As it brings people downtown, hopefully there'll be more establishments that can cater to the types of crowd that the Empire is going to attract.
You've got coffee shops, restaurants are going to open up, the businesses will want to relocate here because they can have conferences here, they can have their business meetings here and everything. So it's a magnificent facility, and it really says a lot about our soul and our spirit and about what we believe in the future.
The Empire Theater has had the opportunity to entertain generations past and present. The future looks to be even more entertaining. For Studio One, I'm Andy Wakeford.
Andy joins us in the studio to talk more about his story. That theater has had a rocky history.
Yeah, you can say that. It opened in the late 1919 was when it actually opened. And it was real popular through the 20s, 30s, and even in the 40s and into the 50s. And when TV became popular, the decline of the theater, that's kind of when it started. Less people would go to the movies. And even now into the 1990s, that's when the theater was at its basically worst. The theater was becoming run down. The heating wasn't working properly. And they're showing movies for 99 cents. Seats were going for 99 cents.
And then they turned it around to what it is today.
It's unbelievable to see what it came from as kind of a rundown theater to what it is now today. It's an immaculate art center.
And is it successful in bringing people to the center then?
Yes, it is. The opening weekend, where both nights were just packed. And in the future now, that they're having many events in there. The North Dakota Ballet is going to be performing there. Plays, concerts, all sorts of entertaining events will be at the Empire.
All right, well, good luck to them, and thank you for the story, Andy.
You're welcome.
We'll be right back with more on Studio One after this.
Columbia Mall in Grand Forks has been a cornerstone of the Grand Forks economy for over 20 years. Meet me at Columbia is a slogan that has seen friends and neighbors gathering at Columbia Mall. Three main anchors with 80 specialty stores and shops greets customers daily, Monday through Sunday, featuring the very latest in goods and services at the most competitive prices. Shop Target, JCPenney, and Dayton's, along with the specialty stores in climate-controlled comfort no matter what the season. A continuing leader and community cornerstone is Columbia Mall, Grand Forks.
Oh, gee, I mean, you ask the students.
The education that you get is as good as or better than what you can get at anywhere else.
The teachers really go out of their way to help you outside of class.
It's just an incredibly rich opportunity and environment here.
UND's Division of Continuing Education can help you learn throughout your lifetime. Begin or continue your education through correspondence study and learning after hours with classes on weekends and evenings. Or enhance your personal and professional development through conferences, management seminars, and specialized programs.
Our goal is to provide quality programs and extend UND resources to you.
For more information, call 777-4266 or 1-800-342-8230.
What do all these company symbols have in common? This symbol. For more than 20 years, Century Creations Printing has provided creative printing solutions to these companies and many more. Customers know they can trust Century Creations to produce high-quality printing. They also know they can work directly with Century's award-winning graphic arts department to design a print piece that will help them achieve their goals. Creative printing solutions from Century Creations Printing. Now in their new expanded location at 5203 Gateway Drive in Grand Forks.
Committed to economic development, agriculture, and other critical national issues, United States Senator Kent Conrad is hard at work. His efforts have earned him the reputation as a champion of American agriculture. To talk about these issues and what it's like to work in politics, United States Senator of North Dakota Kent Conrad is with us today. Thank you so much for being with us.
Good to be with you, Michelle.
It's great to have you here. And last year at this time, we were mentioning earlier, we were flooded with problems. And you were one of the key people that really helped find some solutions for us as far as bringing money into North Dakota for recovery. Could you explain what that process was like for you?
You know, I was asked this morning if I could remember some of the specific incidents. One I remember especially well is when the mayor and the tri-chairs were in my office in Washington. We were in the conference room, and we were told we had 30 minutes to come up with how much money we would ask for. And I got out a legal pad, and I said, you tell me, what do we need in terms of rebuilding homes, replacing businesses, the infrastructure of the city? And we quickly came up with a number of over $500 million. And so that's what we asked for. And we then engaged in a series of negotiations that went on for weeks and even months. And it became very heated at times, as you can imagine, because other senators did not want to give us what we thought we needed. And I can remember very well, as we negotiated, having senators say to us, well, we'll give you $200 million, $300 million, $350 million. And we kept saying, no, that's not enough. We've got to have the whole $500 million if we're going to have this community have a chance to recover.
Right.
And so it was an interesting experience to go through.
Right, and it's hard to understand the severity of the problem unless you're here. And I understand that you rallied some leaders from North Dakota to lobby for money in Washington, D.C.
You know, repeatedly I would get on the phone and call Mayor Owens and say, Pat, we need you one more time. And I think I said that to her three or four times.
Right.
So she kept coming and others came with her, and we went door to door showing our colleagues what had happened. And we had a packet of pictures and videos that we used to show them what had occurred in Grand Forks. And the fact, of course, that we became a national story helped us immensely as well.
Definitely. And it sounds like a lot of hard work and some frustrating moments came into play with that. What would you say is one of the more frustrating parts of your job?
Well, I think it's especially difficult when we faced colleagues who themselves had had disasters and gotten help, who weren't as willing to help us as we had been willing to help them. That sometimes is frustrating. But, you know, the good far outweighed the bad. We really had a tremendous response from people. I can remember flying in here with the president and his looking out and saying, you know, I've never seen a flood as extensive as this one. And it was an awesome sight to go north of Grand Forks and see water as far as the eye could see.
Right. Speaking of President Clinton, what is it like to work with so many powerful people?
Well, you have to remember to be persistent.
Right.
One of the things I've learned in Washington, and I think it's true in all of life, is persistence pays. You know, somebody once said 80% of life is showing up. And I think that's very true. I mean, sometimes these simple sayings hold a truth that really goes beyond the simplicity of the statement. And I hope those who are listening remember, in life, if you show up every day and do your job, it's amazing how much you'll get done.
Right. I also wanted to ask you about the tobacco industry really has a fight on its hands right now, and I understand that you've introduced a bill that really targets teens in smoking. What has your role been in this whole issue?
Well, I got named by the leadership to head the Senate Task Force on Tobacco. It's not an assignment I sought or I chose, but I was asked to take it on. And It has been an interesting challenge because we've got 400,000 people dying every year in this country from tobacco-related illnesses. Mm-hmm. It's killed more people in just 1 year than all the people we lost in all the wars that were fought in the 20th century. Right. And so much of it starts with young people, because we now know that if people don't start when they're young, they probably won't start. 90% of smokers start before they're age 19. About half start before they're age 14. And that's why the legislation I've introduced, that's now been co-sponsored by 31 of my Senate colleagues, we call it the Healthy Kids Act, is really geared to reducing youth smoking. Because if we accomplish that, we know over time we'll dramatically reduce the number of smokers in this country and protect the public health.
Right. What are some of your other goals for the future of North Dakota and actually the nation?
Well, I've been very engaged and focused on getting our fiscal house in order. So this is a celebration this year. First year in 30 years, we've balanced the unified federal budget. That's an enormous step forward. The next step is to quit raiding the Social Security Trust Fund surpluses. And I've been engaged in an effort along with some of my colleagues to try to make sure we do that as a next step. In addition, I'm very focused on things that matter to North Dakota. So I've introduced, along with my colleagues from North Dakota, the Dakota Water Resources Act to develop the water resources of our state, and a whole series of economic development initiatives, including the funding for the facility that we're in. This is something I got funded as we went through an appropriations process several years ago, because I was convinced this would help build the economic future for our state.
Right. Well, thanks so much for all you do. I've heard many people say that you really have a heart for North Dakota, and your drive and your focus really pulls us right along. So we're so thankful for all that you do and for coming on the show.
Thank you for having me. I've enjoyed it very much.
Great. We'll be right back after this.
What I like best about Grand Forks is really the people, and that's what any city comes down to. The University of North Dakota, since the flood, is just as great as ever. They really do offer a quality education, dedicated staff and students. The school itself is fine, and I know that the teachers and students are going to come back with even more spirit than last year.
The 1998 Chevrolet CK pickup offers impressive room, comfort, and style. Rydell's in Grand Forks invites you to experience a truck you can depend on over the miles and through the years. Features like push-button four-wheel drive, airbags, anti-lock brakes, optional third door, and more make each day easier and each drive more enjoyable. See the full line of Chevrolet's full-size CK pickups at Rydell's Chevrolet Oldsmobile Cadillac, 2700 South Washington, Grand Forks. Let the University of North Dakota become your strategic partner by providing your business, industry, or organization with our workforce development services. Our experts work closely with you to enhance your workforce productivity. Together, we'll help you develop innovative and practical solutions. The Office of Workforce Development has extensive experience in customizing educational programs and services. Call us for further information. Workforce Development, a service of the University of North Dakota.
What do all these company symbols have in common? This symbol. For more than 20 years, Century Creations Printing has provided creative printing solutions to these companies and many more. Customers know they can trust Century Creations to produce high-quality printing. They also know they can work directly with Century's award-winning graphic arts department to design a print piece that will help them achieve their goals. Creative printing solutions from Century Creations Printing. Now in their new expanded location at 5203 Gateway Drive in Grand Forks.
We'd like to congratulate the University of North Dakota Aerospace Dean, John Odegaard. The university officially renamed his aerospace college after him. Dean Odegaard is responsible for building UND's internationally known aerospace program. He started out with a two-plane operation. Today it is one of the largest non-military aircraft training fleets in the world. Congratulations, Dean Odegaard. Tune in next week to Studio One. We're going to sit in on a class where kids take care of kids. That and much more next week on Studio One. Right now, we're going to leave viewers with a taste of Kids, an affair courtesy of photographer Paul Miller. From all of us here at Studio One, have a great week.